Welcome at this program. We're gonna talk about myth. And yeah, myth, if you look in the dictionary, it has two meanings. And one is a collectively held story, typically about the origin of people or about our relationship to nature, the way in which societies are constituted. And the second meaning in the dictionary of a myth is a widely held but false belief. And we, in Western Europe and in the Netherlands, we seem to have this idea that we are not, that myths aren't that important anymore. We are very rational. We don't have anything to do with myth. And actually, that's what we're going to talk about tonight, about the meaning of mythology. What can we learn from myth? And how are they used to bring people together, perhaps to keep people out? So myth and struggles is what we're going to talk about. Which is interesting because recently a number of authors have turned towards mythology and the retelling of old myth. And a writer like Amitav Ghosh has even said that we need a different type of stories in order to be able to deal with the challenges of our time. And tonight we've invited two very interesting authors who can shine their light on this topic. And the first one who will be reading for you is Arsha Sattar, who will be reading from Valmiki's Ramayana. And after that, you'll also hear Jennifer Makumbi. But first, the stage for Arsha Sattar, Valmiki's Ramayana.
Thank you. Good evening. For people who don't know the story, the larger story, I'll just tell you very quickly. It's about a very honorable prince, one of four brothers, whose father had three wives. And on the day before Rama, the hero of our story, was going to be crowned king, his stepmother decided that she wanted her son to be king and that Rama should be banished into the forest for 14 years. So Rama goes into the forest with his wonderful, beautiful wife, Sita, the most beautiful princess in the whole world, gentle, kind, compassionate, you know, you get the picture, and his loyal brother. And while they're living in the forest, they undergo many trials and tribulations, but the worst of them all, the most devastating, the most catastrophic, is that Sita is abducted by Ravana, who is the king of the Rakshasas, and lives on an island in the middle of the ocean, and he abducts her from the forest, and he takes her to live in, he takes her captive and places her in the island. So I was asked to give an excerpt, and I was asked to make it, to give it, an excerpt that was fully mythological. So I'm going to read the abduction scene, because it contains many things that myth represents, and then we'll talk about it differently a little bit later. So Sita is alone in this hut in the forest, and Ravana comes to her in the disguise of an ascetic. He's dressed like a mendicant, like a very harmless religious person. "If you so much as touch me," blazed Sita, her eyes red with anger, "you might as well have drunk poison." Ravana rubbed his hands together and reverted to his natural form. "Crazy woman," he said harshly, "you were obviously not listening when I told you about my power and my strength. I can stand in the sky and lift the earth in my hands. I can kill death in battle." Ravana's eyes blazed like the setting sun and were as bright as fire. He had thrown off the disguise of a gentle ascetic and appeared in his true form, which was as terrifying as death. And he stood there with his 10 heads and bright jewels. "Lovely lady, if you want a husband who is known in the three worlds, then come with me. I am worthy of you. Give yourself to me and I shall be worthy of your love. I will never do anything to make you unhappy. Give up your attachment to this wretched mortal and turn your affections to me. You think of yourself as wise, but you are very foolish. how can you remain attached to a man who has given up his kingdom, who cannot accomplish his goals, and whose days are numbered? Speaking brutally to gentle Sita, who deserved only kindness, Ravana grabbed her roughly. With his right hand, he caught her by the hair, and he placed his left hand under her knees. The forest deities fled in terror when they saw Ravana with his great arms and his huge teeth. Ravana's golden chariot appeared, drawn by braying donkeys. Ravana lifted Sita by the waist and ranted on as he placed her in the chariot. The enormous bird Jatayu was dozing gently nearby, but he awoke when he heard the screams and saw Ravana and Sita. Best of all birds, Jatayu was the size of a mountain and had a sharp beak. He spoke gently to Ravana from his perch on the tree. Ten-headed Ravana, I'm Jatayu, the king of the vultures. I'm strong and mighty and honorable, and I cleave to the eternal Dharma. Rama, the son of Dasharatha, is the lord of all the worlds. Equal to Varuna and Indra, he's devoted to the welfare of all beings. This woman you are abducting is his wife. She's the best of women. How can a righteous king carry off another man's wife? I am 60,000 years old now, Ravana. You are young. You are mounted on a chariot, clad in a coat of mail and armed with bows and arrows. Despite that, you cannot carry off Sita so easily. If you are truly brave, step out for a moment. You shall not succeed in abducting this lotus-eyed lady, Rama's beloved wife, as long as I am alive. Wait and watch, Ravana. I shall pluck you from your chariot like a fruit from a tree. Ravana's golden earrings glittered, and his 20 eyes turned red with rage. The king of the Rakshasas pounced on the great bird, and a huge battle ensued in the sky between the two mighty beings, like the clash of winged clouds. Ravana rained iron-tipped arrows upon Jatayu, but the king of the birds caught them all. He wounded the Rakshasa several times with his talons and his sharp beak. He shattered Ravana's bow and destroyed his chariot, biting off the head of the charioteer and also the heads of the donkeys that were yoked to it. Ravana fell to the ground, holding Sita on his lap. Jatayu pursued him and threw himself on Ravana's back. He dug his talons into the Rakshasa and mauled him all over, riding him as if he were a rogue elephant. He bit off Ravana's 10 right arms with his beak. Ravana attacked the bird with his fists and feet. But even though Jatayu fought harder and harder for Rama's sake, Ravana cut off his wings and his feet with his sword. The wingless bird fell to the earth, scarcely a breath left in his body.
So, thank you for your wonderful reading. We promised struggle and myth. We got struggle and myth. At the table also Maart van de Graaf, a poet. And Arsja,
yes.
You hold a PhD in South Asian languages. You've translated a number of texts from Sanskrit, and you've been working with the Ramayana for a very long time. So, why this fascination? What is it that captivates you so much?
Well, like all great stories and all great myths, this is a story about the conflict between good and evil. Yeah, it is essentially a story of a battle between a good man and his enemy. I don't want to say bad man, because there's, you know, that's where the us and them business starts. It's also a story about how to be human. It's a story about how difficult it is to be good. It's a story about how to be a husband, a son, a brother. So it's a story that will, to my mind, forever and always be relevant, not simply to Indian culture, or to Hinduism, of which it is a very essential part, but I think it's a truly universal story, And honestly, I mean, I've been working with the text now for 30 years, which is a little bit embarrassing that you read only one book, you know. But honestly, every time I read it, I think, oh my God, there's something new. I never saw this before. I have to write about it. And every time I think I'm done with the text, one more book suddenly comes out, you know. I think that's true, not only of Ramayana, but all great stories are like that, mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm fascinated how you can live your entire life in one myth, in one story. Uh-huh. And I'm wondering about how did you first encounter it, do you think? What was the first time you stepped into it?
Well, many myths, many traditional myths, I should say, because there's this modern category of the urban myth, you know, the alligators in our sewers and the murderer who has one hand as a hook and all that. Yeah. Not those myths, the foundational myths of a culture. We don't actually remember the first time we heard them. Uh-huh. Yeah, so somehow we imbibe the, like osmosis or something. But what I do remember, and you know, my family is Muslim. I have to say that I had a completely deracinated upbringing. But, you know, we in the house there was Muslim culture. We eat Muslim food, we wear Muslim clothes, our languages, you know, is what Muslims speak. But when I was very little, I had a nanny, I had an ayah, who was not Muslim. She would put me to sleep, and she would tell me stories. And I realized much, much later, when I was 11 or 12 or 13, when I got a book of the Ramayana, I realized that I already knew the story because my Roshni had told it to me. Yeah. And it's also, I mean, and since I've been working with the text now for so long, I've had to examine my own relationship with it and my own reactions to it. And I recall that hearing Ramayana, when you know the scene that I read when Sita is abducted, it's my first memory of fear. Ah. I thought, oh my God, Ravana is going to come and take me as well. You know, So I mean, if it's that intense, then yeah, I'm gonna. But you know, if you ask my mother why am I connected to Ramayana, she said because I was bitten by a monkey when I was 3 years old.
So, really?
Yeah, yeah. She had a very rational explanation. Unlike
that's very
mine.
Very unfortunate.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. Okay, that's a fascinating story for which hopefully we'll have time later. Yes. First, I want to invite Jennifer to also come to the States and read from her novel Shintu. It's a really wonderful novel, but we're going to talk about that later. Jennifer holds a PhD in creative writing and currently teaches writing at the University of Manchester. And I'm delighted to say that the Dutch translation rights of the novel have been sold to Cossey. So we'll be looking forward to the Dutch translation from what Jennifer will be reading.
Hello. Thanks for being with us this evening, especially when it's so cold outside. I'm going to give you a bit of a context about the story I'm going to read, the piece I'm going to read. So it comes from my novel called Chintu, but it comes from the part that is set in... talking to me at the back. It comes from my novel, Chintu, but it comes from the part that is set in the 1750s, when what you call Uganda now used to be Buganda Kingdom. And at the time, the kings were fighting each other, brothers against brothers, and just killing each other, you know, like the Shakespearean kind of succession. And the main character is called Chintu, and he is traveling to the city, or to the capital, to pay homage to the new king. And at the moment, right at the beginning of the novel, his problem is mainly his wives. As a chief, he has so many wives, but he has twin wives that live in the same house. Now, I must tell you something about twins in Buganda. if you have twins, even up to now, you're considered special. We revere twins where I come from. A man is renamed after making twins, and his wife, of course, is called Nalongo, and the father is called Salo, which means just ultra virile. And in the children, even those who had been born are renamed so that the world knows that somebody had twins. But this Chintu is having problems with his wife. So the horizon cracked in scarlet rays. The party had a few precious minutes to enjoy sunrise before entering the second phase of the forest. Chintu's mind strayed to his wives, Babidi and Nakato. He would rather have dealt with mutiny in his army than Babidi, even though she was a replica of his beloved wife, Nakato. He never wanted to keep two women in the same house in the first place, not even identical twins. Now, tradition claimed that identical twins were one soul who, failing to resolve the primal conflict in the self, split and two people were born. The older twin, named Babidie, if it was a girl, was supposedly the original soul. Nakato, the younger twin, was a copy, the mutineer. But Chintu could not see how this could be true of his wives. For him, Nakato was the original. Rather than being selfish, Nakato was the pacifier who always allowed Babidie to have her way. Surely it had to be Babidie who had fallen out with Nakato. She had pushed and shoved until Nakato stepped out of the way. Babidie was born first and became the dominant twin thereafter. They were now inside the second part of the forest. The foliage was wet, as if it had just rained. The canopy blocked the early sun. Still, Chintu could see well. Huge mahogany trees rose and soared, splitting into a canopy of dense branches. The shrubs below were lanky, making thin undergrowth. The forest floor was carpeted in a thick layer of decomposing leaves. Tiny, hard black seeds littered the ground. Once in a while, they came upon an ancient tree with roots so wide and webbed above the ground that towered over the men. Chintu's mind lingered on the primal conflict and that led to a soul splitting into twins. No matter how he looked at it, life was tragic. If the soul is at conflict, even at this remotest existence, what chance do communities have? This made the Ganda custom of marrying female identical twins to the same man preposterous. It goes against their very nature, Chintu thought. Twins split because they cannot be one. Why keep them as such in life? Besides, identical men did not marry the same woman. But even as he raged against custom, Chintu knew that in the world of twins, things could be worse. There were people born with a single soul only to bear twin personalities. There were people born as single souls. There were more tragic where twins who changed their minds too late and arrived conjoined. Thank you.
Jennifer. Thank you for your reading.
Okay.
Chintu tells the story of Uganda told through the perspective of a curse unleashed by Chintu, who we first meet when on his journey. How did you come at this idea to tell the story of a country from the perspective of a curse?
Oh God, that was so long ago. It started with my dad. My father was, during Idi Amin's regime, my dad was a banker. And one time, And a main man came to the bank and gave them what my father called a rubber check. You know, bounced, and everybody else said, I'm not going to be the one to say you can't have your money. But my dad, it was he's human. Just tell them that, you know, you don't have enough money on your account. And the man said, I want my money. And the dad said there was no money. So the guy went away. When dad finished work, he found men waiting for him outside, and they bundled him into a car boat, and they took him away and really brutalized him. Now, I must say, we got him back, which is a lot more than most of my friends at school did. But my dad lost his mind. And for a long time, we thought, okay, he was brutalized and he lost his mind. But then later, one time when the family got together, someone said to me, don't count on that. It runs in the family. And at that point, I was like, I might get it. And she said, oh, it's a curse. So that was the seed with me trying to work out my anxieties, that where the idea of a curse came from. However, when I came to Britain, and this idea of the book was playing around in my mind, I started to see Africa being played out on TV as this mad place. I mean, I'd grown up there. And yes, we had wars, we had problems, but it was life. But what I saw on the film, on the TV, I was like, oh my God, which Africa is that? I don't know that Uganda. I just could not believe it. It was just madness. Even I started to say, oh my God, they're mad. it was this ridiculous myth created about Africa as, you know, this madness. And I thought, okay, well, let's play with madness. So that's where then I took it to a national and a continental level.
The title of another story that you wrote was Let's tell this story properly.
Yes.
And in Chintu, we heard about the twins and the themes of separation and coherence.
Yes.
So how did this story of Chintu, which goes back to a creation myth, right?
Yes.
How was it a proper telling of this story that you wanted to
tell? Proper.
Tell, yeah.
Oh God, you're playing around with the title.
I'm sorry, it's a complicated question.
Here's the thing. When colonization happened, there's what we call bringing a brush and painting out everything traditional you found. So the traditional stories were all painted out, and we all took Adam and Eve as our beginning. I grew up as a middle-class child, so I had access to Roald Dahls and In the Blightened, and, you know, so I grew up with those stories as well. And I read quite a lot. And then I started writing. And I realized that my tradition was nowhere. It was not in Shakespeare, which I had done, or the Western canon. And I had to find my way back to the texts that my literary ancestors left behind. And it was Chintu. The first myth where the Baganda sat down and said, this is where we came from. The first man was Chintu, the first woman was Nambi. And if you're Mganda, this is where you came from. That is the text they left behind for me. And I thought, this is where I'm going to start. But when I talk about this kind of, you know, writing out, it's writing Chintu and taking it back to my mythical roots is, it's a kind of like the paint, the colonial paint is beginning to chip away. And these texts that were overwritten are beginning to merge, you know, like what we call a palimpsest.
Yeah.
So that's what I was doing.
It's very interesting to talk about finding your own story or your mythical roots, like you just said.
Yes.
It reminds me of this character in Shinto that is called Mishi. Yeah, that in the end of the book, somebody says about him, he had two ways of knowing, of knowledge.
Yes.
One was rational in the way the West would see that.
Yeah.
The education in the West gave him that knowledge. Yeah. But there was also this other way of knowing.
Yes.
And then his family talks about him and they say he refused to know that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, that is true. So here's the thing. We in Uganda, you get this education that is Western. It's constructed in a Western way, even if Ugandans are dispensing it now. But there's also knowledge that you inherit. It's going away. But I was lucky to have grown up with my grandfather, who was very controlling of the family. So he would say, yes, they have to read those books, but in the holidays, send them back to the village. I need to talk to them. So I got a lot of other ways of knowing. And so we in Africa have taken on the Western idea that the only way of knowing is cerebral, okay? Mm-hmm. But there are other ways of knowing, okay? And in Africa, they had been developed along with the cerebral. So let me give you an example. It's that time, well, maybe this might not be helpful, but in Uganda, the dark is really dark. You know, the night is absolutely dark. You know, but sometimes you could be walking in the dark and you realize you've got to stop. And you stop. And then a snake crosses. Or you see a leopard going past. You know, it's that knowledge. But we can't quantify it. I can't bring that knowledge to a Western university and say, huh, let's discuss this. Let's put it in a, you know, theorize it, or let's find a formula for it. If I bring it to a Western university, I'm going to be left out of the seminar. Okay? And so we have Missy, who has done a PhD in Oxford, or that kind of university, and he has returned to Uganda.
He's living in the village.
Yes, but he has been chosen, the family, and he has been given a certain specific knowledge that is not cerebral. And the family comes to him and they say to him, look, you are the one who's going to lead us out of this curse. And he says, no, excuse me, we need to theorize this. This is very interesting, you know. And the signs start to appear. You have the bees. And his sister, who's not educated, says, you know what? Do handle those bees with, you know, care. And he's like, yeah, yeah. Sure. You know. Yeah. And in the end, there are so many signs. He starts to wonder. But he cannot let himself, because he has gone the cerebral way too much. And in the end, it's the sister, who's non-educated, who says, that is a problem. He had, on one hand, non-cerebral knowledge, and he failed to acknowledge it.
Can I just say, you know, it never occurred to me, but I also grew up reading Enid Blyton, and Roald Dahl was I'm too old to have read Roald Dahl as a child, but we grew up, certainly my generation in India, you know, metropolitan, we went to schools run by Christians, our language was English, so we read all these English books.
Yes.
Right? And so when I started writing as a child, when I was 7, 8, and I was writing my first stories, the girls were blonde, they had blue eyes, their name was Cynthia. I remember Cynthia very clearly. There was a dog called Rover, right? And they were eating sandwiches for tea, and I just thought that was the way stories were told. So when you say that, having read that, you sort of went back to the earliest thing in your own culture that you could find.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, my God, maybe I did the same thing. I went back to the oldest possible thing.
Absolutely.
Indian culture, now called Hindu culture, you know, and sought meaning or alternative or, you know, another way of being in that. You taught me something about my life. Thank you.
If I can just follow up on that, because in a recent essay you wrote also about how you wrote, I've never felt closer to the gods than than working with the Ramayana. And at the same time, you voiced concern about the changing context of Hindu nationalism. And so how does this context of increasing nationalism change the reading of this text?
Well, in the most critical of ways, because it becomes a text that establishes us and them. And when the first appropriation of Ramayana by the Hindu right was in the late 1980s, and those days they used to actually say to us that if you don't believe in Ram, you go to Pakistan. You know, we made a country, go there. It's really amazing. It's like, we made a country for you and you're still here, you know? It was quite shocking that a story that, and you know Ramayana, Valmiki Ramayana is the first Ramayana that we have, right? But since in the last 2,500 years, every Indian language has its own Ramayana. People are still writing Ramayana. Women, Dalits, Muslims, tribal people, you know, first peoples, everybody believes that this, they have the right to tell the story. So for one group of upper caste men, it's very important, upper caste men, to take this story and say it's ours and nobody else has the right to tell it, it's just absurd. I mean, it's like, you know, suddenly, I can't even think of an analogy. You know, it's like saying you took the nether out of Netherlands. That is like that. That is like, what am I left with, you know? So increasingly, it's become about identity politics. The excerpt that I read, Ravana, is, you know, the opponent in the story, right? And when we were growing up, he was clearly the villain because he took away the nice lady. But from the 1930s in southern India, Ravana has been heroic because he stands up to Rama. And Rama is seen as spearheading the Aryan, the Indo-Aryan invasion into southern India and oppressing indigenous peoples, right? So that is also identity politics. And this reading of the Ramayana sparked an entire political movement that, you know, is still very critical in the south. But in North India, you know, every year we burn Ravana and, you know, we do fireworks and all like that. So it's... storytelling is critical in that regard because who tells the story makes the story what it is, no? Because as a storyteller, it's your job to tell the story with yourself in it. Otherwise, what's the point? You can copy it.
Yeah.
You know? But as a storyteller, you need to own the story, and then it becomes about identity politics then.
How did
of course, my identity politics are perfect, right? It's my identity
course,
politics
always.
That are troublesome. Yeah.
How did you look at that, Jennifer? Like, who can tell the myth, who can tell the story, who occupies or owns it when you look at, let's say, masculine storytelling or male perspective? How did you look at that when you were writing the life of all these men in your book?
Well, for a long time, myths themselves were very masculine.
Yeah.
Women were telling stories about women rivaling for the husband, you know, and hair stories. But this was masculine. This is how the nation started. But the good thing about oral traditions is that they don't have a signature. They don't have a writer.
Exactly.
You don't sign your name on them. So people can always take them and do things they want to do with them. And so with Chintu, in a way, unlike your text, which can have people splintering or people locking other people out, Chintu is a way that has kind of brought the nation together in terms of that it's not Adam and Eve. And by the way, but it's so close to Adam and Eve, we did not need Adam and Eve, you know.
Right.
For some time, the nation has coerced around that. But also, because it goes back beyond colonization, and there was always this idea that Africa didn't have a history until Europe arrived. And so because it goes back to see where actually Uganda didn't happen at the beginning with the colonization. There was Buganda Kingdom. It only became Uganda because the British could not say Buganda. When we said Buganda, they did not hear the B because the B is very silent. So they just went with Uganda, you know. There's that. So when the book came out, like, everybody knows Chintu. So everybody knew what the book should be doing, okay? Yeah. And I, because I was the first person to do it, I handled it with care. And this is why I have 5 men and 1 woman.
Yeah.
I dared not. And I'm a feminist. I am a feminist.
Yeah.
But there are certain stories you say, I'm not going to pick a fight with the nation,
yeah.
You know? So I left it to, and have the men, they're doing everything there.
Yeah.
But still, I got complaints.
Really?
Oh, yes.
What kind of complaints?
They said that all the men died.
Ah.
I killed all the men. And the women that are in the novel are very strong, especially if there's a woman with a gun, and the gun is a major phallic symbol. She put the gun in the hands of women. It was interesting the way they reacted to it. But as a feminist, there was one major thing that I could not abide with. So in our myth, Chintu, Nambi, the wife, is the sister of death. Death is called Walumbe. And she brings Walumbe. For you, it's the apple or the whatever. For us, there's no pretense. Mm. It's her brother, you know. And therefore, she brought death. This feminine guilt.
Mm.
In the novel, I quickly located with the man. The man brought the cards. I just could not have that. Yes. That is all I did. But they still found fault with me.
I think it's very interesting, this, sorry.
I was just, because for you, sort of, you were saying that Chintu was known to everyone.
Yes.
And I believe that the same holds true, of course, for your work. So how, as a translator, how do you present the story that everyone already knows or thinks that they know?
Yeah. That's the problem, no? And I was saying this last night when I was talking to Hasne. So I did this, it's a big fat book, okay? I mean, so all my friends bought it, very sweet. In everybody's living room, there's my book, front and center, in the bookshelf, you know. But you look at the book and you know nobody's ever opened it, right? Nobody, oh, now all my friends. I'm like, did you not read the book? Why should I read it? I know the story. And I'm like, no, actually, you don't know the story because we've only heard it in these fuzzy ways and all like that. So, which actually makes it more problematic, right? Because for all the reasons that you're saying, I'm a woman, I'm not a Hindu, I'm, you know, dealing with this text that even when I was translating, which was in the early 90s, you know, you have to do it with kid gloves, right? But you think that as a translator, you're very protected. Unlike yourself, you made it up. Yeah. I didn't make it up, right? This Valmiki said like this, and I put it in English, right? But the problem was and remains the fact that nobody actually reads Sanskrit Ramayana, and nobody even reads my translation of it. So when people argue with you, they're like, hey, guy, but that isn't in the book, right? Like, no, of course it's there. And he's like, no, it's not. No. So the sense of, I mean, the same sense of ownership that I claim for Ramayana, everybody in India, right, is like, no, it happens. So it's very difficult to fight people's imaginations, you know? I mean, it's the impossible battle because you can't see the enemy. It's just like, it's everywhere. But yeah, there are choices I made. There are choices for English words. And I was very young when I translated it. I was in my mid-30s. If somebody asked me to do this now, I'd say, please. But, you know, when you're 30, you think the world belongs to you. What is that? Translate Ramayana? Of course, bring it on. But I never, ever, ever wanted to be provocative. right? And I just come out of a PhD program, and you know how it is when you come out of a PhD program, right? Scholarship is everything, rational, objective, all like this. And I honestly thought, and I still think it's true, that for a translator's job is to make your language as transparent as possible, because what you are seeking to put out there is not your own voice, yeah, but the original writer's voice. You can be like in the harmony track, but it cannot be your voice. So I was extremely, extremely careful in how I translated. Yeah,
that is interesting, because for me it was very different. For me it was, okay, I've inherited this myth, but I'll be damned if I leave it the way I found it. So for me, it was to breathe new life in it. And I think this is the good thing about myth, that they're performed, the oral myth, and every performer brings something new to it. Yeah. You drop something which is no longer relevant to your community, and you pick up things, make up things, which are relevant. So Chintu, the one who came down on a rainbow, and might not be so relevant, but I am going to leave behind another kind of Chintu, which another generation will build on to keep the story going.
Can I just respond to that very quickly?
Very quickly. Because,
so here's the thing, because you know the story is yours.
Yeah.
I'm not a Hindu, I'm translating Ramayana, right? And I'm like, okay, man, this is what it is. Done.
Wow. So we've heard a lot about myth, and I'm sure that we could keep talking. But every performer has its own myth, and we also have Rodan Al-Khalidi here tonight to perform. And you probably all know him. I'm looking if he's... He isn't? Yeah. the poem he was... poet has sort of... mystified the experience, or made a myth out of the existence as a refugee in the Netherlands. So that's who we are inviting next. But first, I want to thank you, Arsia, Jennifer, Maarten, very much for this conversation about myth and knowledge. And thank you.
Goedenavond. Eerste gedicht, verlaat dit boek voor Ophelia van Shakespeare. Lieve Ophelia, verlaat het boek en kom bij mij. In de plaats van het omslag heb ik ramen voor jou. In de plaats van woorden heb ik een hart. Ophelia, kom, zoals ik de mooiste tijden heb gegeven om jou te lezen, zal ik de warmste nachten schenken om je te beminnen. Ophelia, leven is mooier dan eeuwigheid. Ik vind Shakespeare niet leuk. Hij gaf zoveel aandacht aan Hamlet. Die domme Hamlet, maar heel paar pagina's voor Ophelia. Daarom heb ik het gezegd. Eenzame vrouw. Een vrouw koopt een boot en zet die in haar slaapkamer. Ze houdt van zee, vrijheid en rust. Een man komt haar slaapkamer binnen, hij hoort meeuwen en ruikt het zilt van de golven. Hoe magisch de muren als ze gebolde zeilen zijn, en hoe wijd de slaap als ze de verte is. Och, eenzame vrouw, omdat de man geen zee is. Ik ben een beetje feministische Arabier. Het is anti-beroemdheid, dit gedicht. Opeens beroemd. Een Amerikaan, ik denk dat hij Donne Brown heette, bewees misschien als een grap met goed geschreven boek dat Hitler een zoon had die Leo heette, die naar Chili vluchtte vlak na de oorlog. daar zijn naam veranderde in Liorico. Trouwde met een dochter van Stalin die zichzelf daar Liorica noemde en dat hun zoon mijn vader was. Opeens werd ik beroemd en uitgenodigd voor congressen om over vrede te bespreken. Ja, nee, maar het is niet waar, Hitler is niet mijn hoofd. Alleen voor het boek. Ontvoering. Het donker ontvoert mij. In een verlichte kelder bond hij mij aan een bloederige stoel en zei, ik wil dat je de waarheid zegt. Waar en wanneer heb je voor het laatst het licht gezien? Ik zei dat dat lang geleden was. Hij zei, je licht, je ziet het licht en je praat ermee. Hij beval paar lampen mijn geest te geeselen, tot ik de waarheid zei. Ik heb een gekke fantasie, een beetje. De zomer, haar bikini. Over hele mooie vrouwen, die heel erg mooie modellen. Ik herinner me haar, de zomer was haar bikini, de slipper, de bikini voor haar voet. Van haar voet. Ik smeekte of ze eens met mij uit eten wilde. In één keertje, zodat ik er trots op. Ze riep duivel op en smeet de rode roze mijn gezicht. Ik vond een vrouw die mij wilde. Ze vond mannen die haar niet wilden. 50 jaar later zag ik haar weer. Ze was de eenzaamste. De meeste trieste. Lelijkheid die lelijker wordt, is mooier dan schoonheid die lelijk wordt. Verwarring. Mijn moeder vindt dat ik van de psycholoog moet veranderen. De psycholoog is van mening dat ik mezelf moet veranderen. Mijn psychische problemen vinden dat ik van moeder en psycholoog moet veranderen. Ik denk dat ik zo moet blijven en niet nog meer psychische ziektes erbij neem. Oh, dank je wel. Volgens mij zijn veel psychische zieken en zo. Met velen. Alle psychische zieken ter wereld luisteren. Als wij onze psychische ziektes niet verbergen, zijn wij met velen en worden wij de normalen. Wie is Leonard Cohen? Dat is echt gebeurd. Ze zei, Leonard Cohen is dood. Ik zei, wie is die Leonard Cohen? Ze draaide zijn muziek en huilde. Voor haar was Leonard Cohen net gestorven. Voor mij was hij net geboren. Het is ode aan de Nederlandse vrouw. Ik vertel het verhaal altijd voor het gedicht. Nederlandse vrouw is prachtig. Maar als je haar net ontmoet en gaat thee met haar drinken, ze gaat de plannen met jou maken voor de komende 45 jaar. En de titel is Ode aan de Nederlandse vrouw. De Amerikaanse vrouw zegt, ik wil met je vrijen. De Arabische vrouw zegt, maak kinderen met mij. De Franse vrouw zegt, zullen we zoenen? De Spaanse vrouw zegt, ik wil met je dansen. De Belgische vrouw zegt, rode wijn of witte. En de Nederlandse vrouw, och. De Nederlandse vrouw zegt, ik wil oud met je worden. Ik ga afsluiten met dit gedicht, waarom Nederland geen grote dichter heeft. Het is alleen een grap, ik meen het niet. Engeland wilde Shakespeare ruilen voor Remco Kampert. De Nederlanders vroegen zich af hoeveel de verzekering van Shakespeare zou kosten. hoe oud hij precies is, hoeveel voer hij heeft nodig en hoe hoog zijn transporting kosten. Of hij goed kan galopperen of karretjes trekken. Of hij hinnikt na 10 uur 's avonds. En toen Shakespeare duurder bleek te zijn dan Remco Kampert, weigerde ze de rouw. Zo bleef Nederland zonder grote dichter. Dank je wel, hè.